Hello and welcome to part two of our special bonus edition of Consciousness Central, coming to you from the Science of Consciousness Conference 2016 here in Tucson. I'd like to welcome Dr. Mani Bhaumik to Consciousness Central. Dr. Bhaumik is a physicist at UCLA. He works in a research laboratory there. And he's also been involved with Tour de Science of Consciousness in arranging for an award to be given to participants who have brought science to a wider audience and made progress in the field of consciousness research. And our good friend Sir Roger Penrose was recipient of this one in 2014, and this year the award went to the Center for Consciousness Studies and Stuart Hameroff, the director. So I want to say thank you to Dr. Bhaumik for that very generous gesture, and welcome.
Well, thank you so much for having giving me a chance to be here and express my thanks in public to Stuart and the Center for what they have done, and especially when it started in 1994, it was only 300 people, and this time, as you know, it's 1,000 people with 60 from 60 countries, and right now the fundamental theory of consciousness is, I have to say that it is the Penrose Hameroff theory based on quantum physics.
So you're a great supporter of their theory. You are a physicist. For a lot of people, their theory is a little bit uncertain. There's a lot of skeptics out there in the world. What is it about OrcoR and Penrose Hameroff model? What is it about that that you find appealing and that seems to be correct for you?
Being a physicist, we have learned that anything that is fundamental has its origin in quantum physics. And the universe is quantum at the core. And consciousness, is it fundamental? Well, what kind of thing do you have in the universe that is an instrument of perception as well as the perceived entity itself? It's unique in that sense. And after all, it is the window through which you not only perceive all reality, but also our emotions and joys that colors our life. If that is not a fundamental entity, I think would be very difficult to have our concept of reality. And in fact, Roger has done a wonderful job with his seminal book, The Emperor's New Mind. And in fact, with his tremendous prestige and being known as the best living mathematical one of the best living mathematical physicists, he put his considerable prestige to show that consciousness has to be fundamental. And if it is fundamental, as a physicist, I know that it has to be quantum in origin. How it is acting, that's of course, quantum mechanics is involved there also. But very ontology of it, where does it really come from? What is the source of it? Has to be quantum. And that's the only theory that Penrose and Hameroff's theory that has been around. It has been knocked around, but still standing tall. And I think getting more acceptance every day, except for Roger's proposition that gravitational self-energy is the one that reduces the wave function. That is still controversial, but it doesn't need that as a reduction. There are other reduction processes, just the popular decoherence theory reduction that could always work. So I don't think that's a flaw in the theory. So I believe that's the only quantum mechanics-based theory, and because I believe quantum consciousness is a fundamental entity, it has to come from the quantum source, which is the quantum vacuum, which is where all we know is coming from. Everything that we have in the universe has its ultimate source in the quantum vacuum. That's what quantum field theory tells us today. It is a theory that has been developed using the two pillars of modern physics, quantum physics and special relativity, both of which goes to Einstein for his contribution, and it has really changed our worldview totally. For example, here we're sitting, we are familiar with the objects and how they're dynamically changing and so forth, but we're not even aware, or we don't have any perception of that the source of all of this, everything is everywhere, always, throughout the universe, and exactly the same everywhere, and has been the same since almost the beginning of time. And if this is something you tell some people, what kind of thing you've been smoking, you know? but it is hardcore pure science. And how do you know that that field is there? You can't, because you cannot see, or you cannot have any perception of it. Well, there is a lot of experiments that has been done. To begin with, was Casimir effect, where between two electrical plates in vacuum, there is nothing at all. You see a ghost force, which is wouldn't go away, just like microwave background in the universe would not go away. And then we have technically called electron spin G factor, and that has been calculated with this theory. And experimentally verified, one part in a trillion, and there is this cosmic microwave background has fluctuations on it, which is a source is given to the fluctuations of the quantum field. So even though quantum field may be superseded someday by a more encompassing theorem, but the basic tenets of it, I believe, it would survive. Because it has explained the whole standard model of particle physics, and to an unbelievable accuracy. So, just like, to give an example, Newton's law is still good. We use it for designing cars, daily objects, and spacecraft. But when you go to higher speed or stronger gravity, it doesn't hold. You have to. Arena is enlarged by general relativity. But Newton's law still holds good. So if quantum field theory is replaced by some larger theory, they're talking about a grand synthesis of all the string theory, quantum field theory, Roger Penrose's twisted theories, spin network, and all of that, that all of that grand synthesis will come out, space-time and quantum physics. But that would not get rid of this quantum field theory. And what it says that, the Nobel laureate Frank Wilczek asked Freeman Dyson, what have we learned from quantum field theory? And he said, well, why? All electrons in this universe are identical, exactly identical. You have many electrons in your body, and also other fundamental particles. I have the same electrons. And they come from the same source. And because their value is exactly same, no matter where or when they have been created. And so that means and those particles are excitation of the quantum field. In that sense, we're always inseparably connected to that field, which is everywhere. And through that, since your electrons are like my electrons and everybody else, everything else, that we are always connected to the source, at least physically. Now we're trying to find out where does consciousness fits into that.
Excellent. And on that note, I'd like to say thank you very much, Dr. Bhaumik, for talking to me this afternoon. And I appreciate your support for TSC as well. Thank you.
Well, I wish I could do more, but I will keep supporting Roger. And I've been supporting other places also as well.
Excellent. That's very much appreciated. And now over to our special guest roving reporter, Dorian Electra.
I'm still Dorian Electra, I think, and we're here with Ed Lance, is it? And he's got some really cool looking pictures on his poster that I want to know about. I see some cool looking performance light show things. Can you tell us a little bit about it, Ed, and how it relates to consciousness?
Sure thing. Well, this is all about immersive media. And what I do is I talk about here about quality of life factors. So you have clean water, you know, you want to eat organic food and take supplements and all that sort of thing. But there's also the inner quality of life factors. And the way to get in there is through the broadband interface of the eyes and the ears. And immersive media like virtual reality is a broadband interface to the brain. So what we've done is we've put a dome theater downtown Los Angeles, and we create transformational programming of all different kinds. So we've done ballets, we've done concerts, we have, the performer's up on a stage and the imagery completely surrounds the audience and goes behind their head. And so what it is it has a profound effect on your psyche. Now that can be used in various ways. It could probably be used to traumatize you like PTSD, or it could be used to heal PTSD. It could be used to awaken you. It could be used to evoke deep emotions and empathy. So we've been experimenting with various kinds of programming. We also do domes off campus. We've done dining experiences for Stella Artois, a lot of corporate stuff we do. This is actually an electronic dance music party for the founder of Minecraft and 3,000 of his best friends.
Cool.
We had Skrillex and Diplo and DJ Snake spin. And 3,000 people fit inside this 200-foot diameter dome.
Wow.
With 24 video projectors, edge blended.
That's awesome. My question is, hey, can I get one of these for me and my band?
Oh, yeah. Well, come to LA and you can perform. Or you can get a little small digital spa.
Ooh.
And lay back in a vibrant acoustic lounger. And we have meditative shows. We're working with Paul Hussenstam, who's a mandala artist, to create shows. And every show that we do in the dome, we also put out on a headset version, so you
can do it at home. Take a little bit with you.
Yeah.
Take a little bit with you after the experience.
So we see this as a ecosystem. You have the out-of-home dome experience for big groups of people,
mm-hmm.
And then you have the at-home private viewing, in the headset.
That's really cool. Awesome. Thank you so much. I'm glad that you're here at the conference. I'm here with Steven. He's going to tell us about what it is we're looking at and listening to.
What you'll see, we have two people in the chairs, back to back. Of both of them, we're recording their EEG on the back of their heads. And we're focusing on the alpha rhythm, which relates to the cortical excitability, the degree to which they're visually engaged. And what we're doing is transforming the power in this frequency band, which fluctuates spontaneously, but also when you're paying attention. We're changing that, modulating it, analyzing it, and feeding it into a modular synthesizer. In that way, we're able to create different elements of sound and modulate different elements of sound. And because they're together, and they're modulating different elements of the sound, they can even communicate and play around a little bit. So.
How much is the person operating the modular synth, how much are they creating the patterns that we're hearing, and how much is being created by the brainwaves?
Well, the signals that we're creating from the brain are really control signals. So they control elements of these patches, of these droney sounds. Of this could be the pitch of a sound, the filter of a sound, the speed, the rhythm. Anything really, because these modular synthesizers are made to be connected and create complex behavior. And so it's also a bit of a metaphor of the brain, where you have all these elements that do different that change different elements of the different aspects of the sound. But we're just modulating, changing it, completing complexity.
What was that like? What were you focusing on, thinking? All I know is I've done some kind of like neurofeedback thing before, and I'm pretty ADD, so my thing was going all over the place, yeah. What was this like?
I mean, I didn't know what was going on there, In the beginning, I was actually, my master told me last time, because it's my second time only, he told me to count 7x7, like, so I started with that, and then that became really boring after a while. So I don't know, and then eventually I started listening to the music. I think there were some beats and I don't know, afterwards you just start thinking less and less, I guess.
Well, this is the first time I do it with... not alone.
A duet.
It's my first duet, and it was really interesting because it was like, usually there's like one focus, but all of a sudden I kind of felt I went a lot of different places, so focusing on her, focusing on the music, going inside, focusing on the body, and sort of going a lot of different places.
I take the signals coming from these two subjects here.
subject A, subject B.
And so they're going through, going from their heads to Stephen's computer, and then from there, CV signals, control voltage is generated. So I route that into my modular and try and make something interesting out of it.
The reason that I'm here is because I thought it was cool that they were doing it last time, and I asked if I could play. So they let me play last time, but I could check the screen, or, you know, I could just turn around, look what was going on. So you get the feedback. And this time I had no idea. There's the sound, there's the rhythm, but I have no idea if my master is creating it, if I'm creating it. Like, this one was a bit blurred for me.
Well, like I said, I go in and out of it, but there was definitely moments where I had like, oh, I'm controlling everything.
What do you want to do next? More people?
Well, in Los Angeles, we did a performance together with a hypnotist. So the audience was hypnotized and Pear was hypnotized. And that is something we want to explore more, because that was really amazing.
And the benefit of the hypnosis is that you'll generate a state in which a person is in for a little while. You really maintain that state by keeping them engaged in imagination, or keeping them engaged in navigation, or whatever. And that is perfect for our purposes, where we want to have slow changes in these brain states. So I think that's something which is both very practical as well as very interesting, because we also engage the audience in another way. So the audience can get involved more into the music and more into this feedback loop.
And it's also interesting because I really felt like I was an instrument. I was really just I was part of the orchestra. I was like, okay, you know, here I was. Particularly when you hear people laughing and you sort of hear these sort of noises in the background, it sort of makes you a little bit self-conscious. But with the hypnotist, I was gone. No? Like,
have you ever been hypnotized before?
Yeah, and I know that I'm very easy to hypnotize, basically.
Ah, we'll keep that in mind. Cool. Thank you guys so much. This is awesome.
My next guest is Kelvin McQueen, originally from New Zealand, now in the physics department at Tel Aviv University. His background is philosophy. Welcome, Kelvin.
Thank you.
Okay, so how does this work for you? How does a philosopher end up in the physics department?
Well, I began studying explanation, originally because I wanted to explain consciousness, and I found that so hard that I looked into what is explanation itself, and so then I began looking at science, scientific explanation, and that just got me into physics. That got me into quantum mechanics, because it's not even clear that our best physical theory explains much at all about the observable world. This is one of the foundational problems in quantum mechanics, which in my talk today I called the problem of quantum reality. And that just got me very drawn to quantum mechanics. So on the side, I began writing about quantum mechanics as well, and just got very interested in it. And a professor at Tel Aviv University read some of my work and invited me there just for a year to collaborate for a little while. And that's really how I got into it.
Okay, so let's go into this a little bit. What are you discovering from quantum mechanics that either is holding you back or helping you?
Well, in quantum mechanics, the primary equation of motion, which describes how physical systems evolve over time, has very strange implications. So what it entails about any measurement we do in quantum mechanics is that the result of the measurement doesn't yield a definite measurement outcome. Instead, what we get is what's called a superposition of all possible measurement outcomes. And that's very strange. So Schrodinger, when, so the equation I'm talking about is the Schrodinger equation, and Schrodinger immediately realized this himself, and he illustrated it in the famous Schrodinger's cat thought experiment, where the cat evolves into a superposition of being alive and dead. So orthodox textbook quantum mechanics tries to resolve this in a very strange way. It just says, well, when a measurement occurs, postulate a new law of nature which tells you that the superposition of outcomes collapses into one, and then everything's okay. But that seems very unsatisfactory, partly because this new process, this collapse, is meant to happen on measurement. But what exactly is measurement? And you can kind of see how this might relate to consciousness, because one proposal for what measurement might amount to is conscious observation. And that's an open hypothesis, and that's actually what I talked about today.
Okay, so that comes to us from the early quantum pioneers, people like Heisenberg and Schrodinger and Niels Bohr and people like that, the observer effect. And again, David Chalmers last year in Helsinki was talking about, well, what is a measurement anyway? You know, these things are hard to sort of penetrate somehow. What's your idea on this?
Well, so I'm working with David Chalmers on this actually, and I think there are a lot of promising proposals actually. I don't think we're in a situation where we can say this answer is definitely correct. So I think we need to look at a number of proposals, and I'm looking at two in quite a lot of detail. One of them is quite radical on the face of it. What it says is we should just bite the bullet. We shouldn't say that there is any collapse whatsoever. We should embrace the claim that when we do a measurement, what results is a superposition of all possible measurement outcomes, but we should interpret a superposition of all possible measurement outcomes as a multiplicity of measurement outcomes. And this is called the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. What it says is that when you do a measurement, you basically correlate the state of your device to the state of a particle, but the particle's in a superposition, so that when you do the measurement, that superposition is magnified up into the measuring device. The measuring device enters into a superposition, and then when you look at the measurement device to see what the result is, the same thing happens to you. You enter into a superposition of seeing one result and seeing another. So the idea is to interpret that as you actually splitting or bifurcating. And then just as the device split you, you split everything you're interacting with in the environment, and you get a branching of worlds. So this is the multiverse interpretation, or the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. It seems on the face of it quite radical, but in a way it's saying, look, just take the primary equation of motion of quantum mechanics, the Schrodinger equation, and just bite the bullet. It's complete. Don't try and complicate the theory by adding more. Now, the other interpretation that I'm looking at says that the early orthodox hypothesis that there is a collapse is right. And in particular, the hypothesis that measurement causes collapse is roughly correct. We just need to precisify what the notion of measurement, what does that actually amount to? And we're considering the hypothesis that consciousness, conscious observation, is what collapses these superpositions. So the idea is that although the Schrodinger equation entails that when you do a measurement, what results is a superposition of all possible measurement outcomes, doing a measurement involves consciousness, and consciousness causes a collapse of all those outcomes into one outcome. Now, traditionally, that hypothesis was viewed as implausible, or at least not very well defined. What's consciousness? It looks like we're sort of trying to solve one problem by appealing to a phenomenon we don't know anything about. But as we're seeing in the Science of Consciousness conference, we now have quite detailed scientific theories of consciousness. And so we've taken on board one particular theory of consciousness called the integrated information theory of consciousness. And what's interesting about this theory is it gives us a value, what's called phi, for the amount of consciousness of a given physical system. So it gives us a way of looking at a physical system so that we can calculate how much consciousness it has. Basically, it's how much integrated information it has. But the key point is that this theory gives us a number or a value for the amount of consciousness. And what that means is we can basically use the integrated information theory to give a more precise definition of consciousness so that we can say exactly when collapse occurs. So one hypothesis, I considered a number of hypotheses because this is still very open, but one hypothesis is that collapse happens when there is an interaction between the system that is in a superposition and a system that has a certain amount of integrated information. that is a certain amount of consciousness, and then you can say that's when exactly collapse occurs, and that's meant to be a well-defined theory which explains collapse. So those are the two options that I've been exploring. But there's also, I should admit, many other interesting options that cannot be ruled out easily.
I think from a philosopher's point of view, there must be a certain sort of infuriating aspect to this, because, you know, consciousness as we, you know, the definition of consciousness, this sense of subjective experience of something happening, is essentially dimensionless. Try and find the edge of your consciousness, where is it? You can't. It doesn't seem to have a temporal aspect, really. It just seems to be the same thing constantly. We're forever in the now, and past and future seem to be sort of really just ideas. Mm. So is there, from your point of view, do you think you can ever really get something that is sort of satisfactorily get there? Can we really get there? Or is it all, there's always going to be some kind of gap? I don't know. It seems as if, yes, we can look at Tinone's ideas, we can look at Penrose and Hameroff. Yeah, they're satisfying to a certain degree. But does it really get us there? I don't know. How do you feel about that?
I've always had a fairly skeptical attitude in this context. I've typically thought it's very hard to see how consciousness could arise or emerge out of physical processes. And that's, I guess, why I've been exploring what might be seen as this more radical view, where we say consciousness doesn't arise out of physical processes. It doesn't emerge out of physical processes in the way that macroscopic properties like water and whatever arises out of H2O, molecular physics and so forth. This alternative picture is the dualist picture, where we just say consciousness doesn't emerge out of physical matter. It's a distinct kind of phenomena, but it is lawfully related to physical matter. And it's, to some extent, this kind of framework can answer the hard problem of consciousness to some level of satisfaction, because when you pose this problem, why should consciousness emerge out of physical matter? The answer in this framework is, well, it's not quite that it emerges out of it. Rather, consciousness is this other fundamental physical property, and it's lawfully related. It's related by fundamental laws to physical matter. And the usual problem with this view is actually slightly different from the hard problem. It's, well, how could this interaction, if consciousness is fundamental, how could this interaction possibly occur? And that's a very deep and hard problem, and it's led many philosophers to believe that a dualist framework is impossible, and we must somehow just try and make the physicalist framework work, even though it's so hard to see how consciousness could emerge out of physical matter. But again, you know, what I was talking about today and the idea that I've been trying to explore is we can use the collapse of the wave function to define a potential causal role for consciousness in the physical world, even when consciousness is itself fundamental. And so I do think, I don't necessarily believe this theory. As I said, I think in this context we shouldn't be speaking of belief. These problems are just too hard right now. But I see value in exploring this framework because it gives an alternative way of looking at the problem, which may have some promise.
Mm-hmm. Great. How about, you know, when you come here, you listen to people who come from a whole other angle, but somehow they're congruent. So Deepak Chopra, for example, he's coming here with a sort of a non-dual approach, rooted in the Vedanta tradition in the East, and yet, you know, what he talks about is very congruent with what people like Niels Bohr and Schrodinger were talking about. You know, who was it that said the universe is more like a giant thought than an object? So that's idealism, I suppose, that perhaps all of it is consciousness manifesting as what appears to us as being objects, and we're just probing the objects, trying to find the answer in that. Mm. Would you go that far, or is that a step too far for you?
I think it's worth exploring. I mean, I don't think we should just completely blow off any particular hypothesis in this context. But although we can't have knocked down objections to views like this, I do think we should be evaluating them on what they offer us. What can these hypotheses do for us? And in particular, do they yield predictions? I think that's important here. It's good to work towards predictions. And it's not completely obvious to me that a theory like that is going to yield distinctive predictions. Does it yield any predictions that are different from a physicalist theory? It's not completely obvious to me. And I mean, the idea that I was exploring consciousness causes collapse, you can, in principle, experimentally test whether or not consciousness causes collapse, provided you've got a criterion of consciousness, where, and here I was using the integrated information theory. So one reason why I think that route is attractive is because it can potentially yield empirical predictions. And some of these broader hypotheses that put consciousness at the basis of everything, I do think that they're worthwhile exploring, but I worry that they might not be falsifiable.
Great. Okay. Kelvin, thank you so much. That's really interesting. That's a great approach and very exciting. I hope you make some progress with Dave, who's a good friend to us as well. Hopefully we'll have him here tomorrow and, you know, take this a little further. So thanks very much. That's Kelvin McQueen.
So I wrote this poem a few years ago. When I turned 41, my son, who was 12 at the time, said to me, "Mom, next year, you're going to be the answer to life, the universe, and everything." And it just so happened that that year, I was working on my master's thesis, and I was doing a lot of studying about life, the universe, and everything. And one morning, I was sitting in a coffee shop, and I don't like poetry. I've never written a poem before, but suddenly this poem welled up in me, and all I had was my weekly planner, and I wrote it in that. I took a picture of it and posted it on Facebook, so I was able to retrieve it and share it with you. I have indeed figured out the answer to life, the universe, and everything. And it is indeed love. Love does make the world go round. Gravity? Love. Electricity? Love. Magnetism? Love. The strong force? Love. The weak force? Love. 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 Could it be more simple? Could it be more obvious? But we don't see it right in front of us all the time. We don't get it. We're looking for something more. But there is nothing more than love. Love is all there is. Love is the driving force of all creation, of physics, of biology, of metaphysics. Pi equals love. Phi equals love. E equals mc squared equals love. It is all love, love, love.
Upon a sturdy rock of quartz and granite, she found herself again composing the story of a moment infinite. Along a modest bank of a babbling, along a modest bank of babbling, the hues of lucid blue and green gently but swiftly strained along with her lyric. She reveled in the revelation, deep in contemplation. She understood that yet again, not a single foe or friend knew exactly where she be. And in the blissful solitude, she truly felt free. Not alone, but on her own, all except, of course, from the curious company of the sturdy rock and rooted desert trees. And with the sweet caress of the spring breeze, she felt at peace and ease, knowing that even though she hadn't breathed a peep, her prayers were heard. Now, the qualia lines blurred between the idea of being on her own or truly known, for all that she is in entirety and truth isn't by answering the question, what do you do? But if her desert kin were to answer from a rock's point of view, it might say, ah, she sings the songs of the silent kind. She plays with words through her conscious mind. She practices how to play, how to pray, and be kind. She keeps her pages turning and the ink flowing with her fingertips. She flows with the dancing trees and takes in the sweet-smelling leaves. She sleeps on a magic carpet of lush green lawns, while others sit uncomfy in chairs and yawn. She cries tears of radiant joy at her brilliant fortune and good luck to feel the love between a passing pair of courting river ducks. Oh, the sweet, silly, grateful bear of a girl, the desert oasis of a desert would say, the desert oasis would say. She does life in her own silly, sweet, and grateful way. Upon that observant rock along the conscious stream, she lifted her gaze, inhaled and exhaled with a juicy hmm, and bowed in prayers yet again in gratitude, not only from where she was, but where she'd come from. Along the modest bank of that conscious stream of the sweeping green and blue, she gave her final thanks that, in fact, she wasn't alone or on her own. She was with you. Woo!
I have just one thing to say. Panpsychists, they're everywhere.
Nursery rhymes. Brutal. Little Miss Muffet sat on a tuffet, scared half to death by a huge great spider. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall, fell off. Egg yolk, egg white, bits of eggshell, all over the place. All the king's horses, all the king's men couldn't put him back together again. No paramedics in those days. Egg homicide. This is for children. Mary had a little lamb. Well, I've done some obstetrics in my time, but Mary having a little lamb takes the biscuits. We're going to do a nursery rhyme. Be very afraid.
Simple Simon met a pieman going to the fair. Said Simple Simon to the pieman, "What have you got there?"
And the pieman said, "Well, I'm a pieman. I bake pies. I take the pies out of the oven. I put the pies in the van. I take the pies and I bring them here in the van and put them on this tray. The pies. I sell pies, and you ask me what I've got here." Pies. It was a strange encounter.
Another strange encounter occurred on the way to Tucson. We met a pieman with no shoes on.
We thought that he was slightly weird.
With long gray hair and long gray beard.
And he wore a long pink dress.
And makeup that was all a mess.
Nonetheless, he was alluring.
Confident, reassuring. So catching us with his eye,
he promptly sold us one big pie.
"Tell me, sir, what's it got in it? If you don't tell, I swear I'll bin it." He shifted then from foot to foot, and munching slyly on a nut, confided like an Oxford top,
"It's full of Stuart Hameroff."
Well, not his body, just his brain. His body's lips, he's not in pain.
"Hammer off brain pie," I cried. In alarm.
"No need to worry," insisted with charm. "We fitted a brain that works quite well.
Except it makes a burning smell.
Every time he sits and thinks, he stops and stares, goes blank and blinks, takes a pen and does some doodles, then prattles on about microtubules."
The pieman paused, then carried on, musing like a Cambridge don.
"The burning, I suppose, is to do with the cogs which bump and croak like demented frogs. The lubricant just gets far too hot. It starts to smoke, then..."
Guess what?
Steam comes out as it starts to boil.
And maybe they shouldn't use vegetable oil.
Pieman looked shifty and in distress.
"And so I say, come on, confess, the whole damn thing is one big lie."
He said, "It's not, just try your pie."
I looked him sideways up and down, and then conceded with a frown.
Like little Jack Horner, he stuck in his thumb. He then pulled it out, looking quite dumb. He plucked up some courage and looked at his digit. There on the end, not a cog or a widget, but a pure human protein, glistening and sticky. Weaker souls would have felt quite icky. But girding his loins, not conscious of sin, he tasted the produce. It was pure tubulin. slightly cooked, with a flavour quite rounded.
Microwaved or ultrasounded?
Could it be that his brain had been fried by all the electrodes that he'd applied? Ultrasound should calm and relax.
Not toast your brain into a lump of hot wax.
Yet, ever since the cerebral replacement, Stu's mind has got stuck in a solid encasement of repetitive babble centered on quanta.
Doesn't it all just make you want to let it all go and stop all the thinking? The pieman by now was shaking and shrinking away from our view, then returned looking wise and pulled from a bag two more great big pies.
And then, with enticement, he said in a whisper,
maybe something more tasty, more crusty, and crisper.
Perhaps if roast Stuart is not quite your thing, some other sweet morsel would surely bring a glint to your eye, sweet scent to your nose. Tell me which one. No, let me propose.
The one on the left, dressed with pyjamas, gustatory delight of delicious chopped charmers.
The one on the right, neath crusty brown ochre, a crispy concoction of deep-fried chopped chopra.
And dare we say, with some trepidation, the latter engaged in deep meditation.
We looked at each other and turned on our heels, running home like greased lightning.
Emitting loud squeals.
Much later we mused on our guru's sad fates as we licked the last remnants of stew from our plates.
Do you think they're in heaven, wearing halos and crombies?
Nah, no chance, mate.
They're mechanical zombies.
I kind of had an out-of-body experience during that poem.
My next guest is Dr. Gino Yu. He is visiting from Hong Kong. Dr. Yu works at Hong Kong Poly University. He works in the field of phenomenology, physiology. He works with video games, consciousness hacking, lots of interesting stuff. Welcome, Gino.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. So tell me what brings you to Tucson and what's your main interest here?
Well, it's the conference, as you know. It get together the world's top neuroscientists, cognitive scientists, psychologists, philosophers, and spiritual teachers to inquire into what is consciousness and how does it work. I'm pretty excited because I'm hosting this conference in Shanghai next year and hosted it in 2009 in Hong Kong. And it's a good opportunity to catch up with the latest work. Really exciting results this year, and meeting a lot of really interesting people, too. This conference seems to collect a lot of really interesting people, from people that are studying this academically, from people that have had experiences and trying to figure out what's going on, to people, like I met one of the people that was one of the heads of Skunk Works for Lockheed Martin, you know, so you have all these different people coming together.
True, very wide, diverse group of people at this conference. So you're working in some very interesting fields, one of which is computer games, and it's very much the interactive nature of computer games and how perhaps we can modify our consciousness or our experience through guided experiences. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Well, I can talk about that a little bit. But actually, my background, you know, I did my bachelor's and PhD at Berkeley in electrical engineering and computer science. And, you know, from that, I ended up traveling around the world, giving a lot of talks as a grad student, presenting papers at conferences. And one of the things that hit me was, you know, when you travel around the world, is how is it that you can have a lot of different people with from different cultures just by making eye contact and having a simple conversation, sometimes not even with language, you're able to connect with people. And so what is it about that, and what is the commonality in man? You know, everyone's born, everyone dies. While they're alive, they have to deal with themselves. And then also from engineering, as an undergraduate, and this is a long time ago, I had the opportunity of working at Bell Labs for a while as a co-op and realized that real life as an engineer, let's just say it wasn't that fulfilling.
And so, like you, I took the money that I made and I bought a recording studio, I bought a video toaster, got involved with media, which seemed a lot more exciting. And I ended up teaching at USC, where they've got probably the best film school in the world and a top 20 engineering school, and got involved with multimedia and games. And then from that, if you think about where we're at in this conversation and where the viewers are at when they're listening and observing this, where is this? So arguably, where we're at right now in this conversation is kind of in the mind and thought, and arguably, this is where you're at when you read a book, watch a movie, or play a video game. You're in the same mental space as those of you who are viewing this are observing us, and you and I are having a conversation. Arguably, this conversation is in this mental space. And so if you think of this mental space as the software, you know, in an analogous perspective, and the physical body is the hardware, what is the relationship between this mental space and the physical body? And so I try to look at consciousness from that perspective, where the physical body is kind of like the hardware, the brain cells, the brain, and what's going on in the body. And this, where this conversation is happening, is kind of like the software. And so our looking at media is really looking at why is it that certain games or certain movies are more attract certain people versus others.
So some might say, you know, in a de facto way, it seems as if, yes, there is a mind-body split, and there is a hardware aspect, which is the solid bits and pieces, and a software aspect, which is the, you know, where phenomenology of consciousness.
Yeah.
And yet there's another point of view that says, well, this is an, you know, there's a non-dual collapse here,
yeah,
and these are actually one and the same thing. Does that help? Does that perspective help you, or do you share that perspective?
Well, the challenge, well, ultimately, if you're using language, the challenge is, what can you talk about? And so the neat thing about the hardware-software paradigm is that, at least on the hardware, our belief systems may be completely different, and our beliefs may be our ideas and beliefs that drive us may be completely different, but the underlying mechanisms are similar. And so, you know, I breathe, I eat, you eat, I pee and poop, you
once in a while.
Yeah. And so these processes are similar. Yeah, and so probably if you drink a lot of alcohol, you'll feel funny, or if you take some certain substances, you could kind of alter your perception of the experience of the moment. And so in some way, seems to be some physical aspect that you may ingest or smoke or what have you that would influence the physiology some way, that would also influence. And the challenging thing, even as a simple thing of our conversation right now, is where is this? Where is this conversation happening?
So,
and what I mean by that is, if I point at this right now, do you see what this is?
This is a pen?
Yeah.
And so we name this a pen?
Yeah. So I'm pointing at this, I'm pointing at something, yes, in space and time,
yes,
in this material world where we're sitting right now.
Yes.
But if I mention that bridge that connects San Francisco to Marin, that's the,
yeah,
a bridge that...
The Golden Gate Bridge.
Yeah. And so here,
yes,
so in this mental realm, arguably,
yes,
in the realm of thought, I just pointed at something too with words,
right,
and you were able to see it just like you saw that pen.
Right.
So this mental world that we're in, where is this?
Mm-hmm.
Physically we're here, but where is this?
Mm-hmm.
There are only three ways in which we figured out how to communicate inner experience in a third person way. And they are, number one, through mythology, through story.
Mm-hmm.
I empathize with the character. Whatever happens to them, I feel as well, too. The second is through art. And so there's the symbolism of things, but then there's the visceral experience of what's happening. And the third is ritual, where you embody the mythology. And it could be symbolic, where this wafer represents the body of Christ, etc. Or you go do a vipassana or sit in a sweat lodge or something, but you embody the mythology. And if you think of mythology, art, and rituals, all the religious traditions around the world are constructed from the mythology, the art, and the rituals. If you take any religion, remove the mythology, remove the art, and remove the rituals, you end up with nothing. And so what happens is these different religions provide a common semantic reference for a group of people to communicate inner experience. And just like Jared Diamond and Guns, Germs, and Seal, different countries evolved, different societies evolved differently in terms of the development of technologies and everything. The landscapes and the animals and the way nature worked was different in these different areas. And so they basically created their own systems for communicating inner experience relevant to whatever the environments were. And so hence we have a lot of these different religious traditions. But arguably, they try to get you to experience an inner experience and they provide a common semantic reference for communicating inner experience. And what I mean by that is, let's say the story of, say, Abraham, for example, and this is from Christianity and Islam, and actually it's from the Jewish tradition too, where God instructs Abraham to kill his son. It's like, well, I love my son, but I love God. You know, what should I do? And if you think about that kind of a thing, it's a conflict that using those symbols is a way of communicating inner strife and inner conflict, right? I love God, mm-hmm. What do I do? And then finally, his love for God is greater than the love for his son. But then God kind of lets him off the hook at the end there. And so the thing is, these different stories are ways of communicating inner experience. But the fact that the experience can be communicated means it's already in your dictionary. It's already in your consciousness. And what I mean by that is, in order for a language to work, it has to have a shared semantic, common semantic reference. And what I mean by that is, if I start speaking Chinese right now, 所以我现在讲国语的话, 可能你看你们懂中文的人可能听得懂我在说什么，可是他听不懂我在说什么，对不对？ Yeah. And so, and so you have to have the same dictionary for communicating. Right. And so the fact that religions have the potential to work means the inner experience is already in your dictionary. And I think, from my perspective, after pondering this for a considerable time, I think there's one core inner experience that all religious traditions get you to experience and to live from. And the experience, is... And I'm going to use words to communicate the experience, but I don't mean the words. I mean the inner experience that the words point to.
Yes,
so I'm going to use the words, so don't look at the finger, look at the moon.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And the core inner experience that I think all religious traditions try to get you to experience and to live from is the experience that right here and right now, it's good to be alive. And so if you feel that, you know, joy, wonder, gratitude, compassion, all of these things come from that. And I'd argue that is the innate joy of being, the realization that, wow, I'm here, I have the opportunity to experience, and from a non-dual perspective, I have a ticket to the show.
Beautiful. Gino, thank you very much. Very entertaining. And yes, we certainly got into some good stuff there. And very interactive as well, I think. Probably our most interactive guest this afternoon. That's Gino Yu.
Thank you.
my mind knows it's true. My body's calling when I'm next to you. It's the yeah. When I'm next to you, 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 ooh, ooh, when you do what you want.
So that wraps it for our programming for Consciousness Central 2016 from the Science of Consciousness Conference in Tucson. I hope you've enjoyed our offerings for this year. Please join us again next year. We'll be coming to you from Shanghai in China. This is Nick Day saying thank you and goodbye.